my Songwriter Series. My special guest is the Tom Speight this week. Guys, he's kind of famous. Yeah, I've done this once before. But we're in lockdown once more.
I really hope for not much longer.
So listen to my Songwriter Series and enjoy the last one.
Hello, hello, hello. Just laughing at my guest laughing at himself when I said he's kind of famous. Hi everyone, and welcome to my last episode of the Songwriter Series. I am so gutted that it's over, but so excited because it means that real life gigs are happening very, very soon. How is everyone doing? I can't see any comments yet, so I hope that means... Is anyone there? Welcome, welcome. So if anyone is new, my name is Lucy May Walker, and this is basically, I think it's the seventh episode of this series. Hello, Jess. Okay, there's people there. Good. Yeah, this is my last one of, I think, 7 weeks now of my series, and every week I've had an artist on, a special guest, and we each exchange three original songs, and we just talk about those songs a little bit more in depth, and then we just have a general chit chat interviewee kind of thing. So yeah, hopefully everything's working. We've had some sound issues, but mostly just me being an idiot. So hello everyone. Hi Shelley, hi Alison, hi Jess, hi Michael, hi Rin, how you doing? I'm gonna start off with the first song of mine, and it's a song that I wrote about Edinburgh. I've been going to Edinburgh every year for, I don't know, like 12 years or something ridiculous. And the past 2 years, apart from obviously 2020, we just ruled that one out, I've been busking at Edinburgh Fringe Festival, and it is like my favourite place in the world. And I just feel like every time I'm there, it's like a little bubble of these people that I hang out with intensely for a month. And yeah, it's called Home From Home.
It's raining. An old friend, haven't seen you in months, but nothing is lost here. You look just the same, and I know that I've changed, but you told me the rainbows won't form without darker days. It's raining again, the streets fill with colours, familiar sound, not like any other city I found. You're like a home from home, there when I need you, I know where to find you. You're like a home from home, whenever I'm with you, I know that I'm never, never. Sounds not like any other
city I found. You're like a home from home, there when I need you, I know where to find you. You're like a home from home, whenever I'm with you, I know that I'm never, never. Go home from home, there when I need you, I know where to find you. You're like a home from home, whenever I'm with you, I know that I'm never, never alone. I have to say, you have to listen to my version of that on Spotify and Apple Music, because it's originally on piano. I just can't play piano. And the piano of that on the actual track is played by Joe Watts, my pianist. And it's amazing. Just listen to it for that. okay, is my guest ready? He's ready. I'm so excited to have him on, and I just think it's the perfect guest to end on, so I will just introduce him onto the screen. He is the wonderful Tom Speight.
Hey guys, how's it going?
Oh, it's working.
Lucy, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
How did the sharing go? I think I've shared it.
I'm not great with social media and technology, but I think people have this this thing that I am okay with these things, but I really struggle with technology and social
media.
Well,
I kind of thought you were going to be fine because, and to be fair, all the issues were on my end, but you didn't ask any questions and I was like, oh, he's probably done loads of live streams and stuff. Have you done any over?
I did a couple on the first one. Mm. Yeah, I did mainly like charity ones, like to raise money for some charities and stuff like that. But yeah, not too many. I'm kind of just itching to play gigs again. I did a socially distanced gig. I think that was in October. And again, it was for like a charity. It was a kind of charity gig. But it just feels like forever since I've played live. So I feel really rusty. So that's why I think maybe when we were talking earlier, you were like, are you going to play any new songs? And I was like, I'm going to play the songs that I've been playing for like 10 years. But just so they
it's
just,
okay.
They're like old friends. They won't judge you too much. But I can't wait for the live gigs, but it's nice. This is a nice thing to do. And I quite liked it because it was about songwriting and stuff. So yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you so much for agreeing to be on it. I've been so excited to have you. We first met at a house concert, Westview Live, I believe is the name, with good old Gary. And I saw recently, didn't you post that you're looking to do another tour of house concerts or something?
Yeah, basically, because of I saw the roadmap thing and I thought maybe we could do some like warm-up shows because I'm not properly touring until February next year. I just thought it'd be a nice little thing to do, and yeah, I think we've already got about 12 booked in.
Oh wow, that's amazing.
So if anyone wants me to play their living room, just get in contact, and it's very
We'd have you, but we live in the tiniest flat ever, so it would literally you just be playing to us. So
okay, well,
What is it that you like about playing house concerts? Because they're very different to your live shows.
Yeah, I think it's just, to be honest, I love just playing live, whether it's a full band or just me and Lydia doing an acoustic set. And it's just, you know, I think it's very important to kind of not get rusty. And I think of it as like almost a bit like a sport, and like being match fit and kind of, you know, almost going into training, doing kind of just, you know, those kind of limberoom gigs. So I think it's important for me to, you know, just to play these songs as much as I can, really.
I think that's actually made me a bit scared, because I think people go, oh my God, these musicians haven't been gigging. I bet they're so excited to play, and we are. But like, I haven't played guitar standing up for a good year and a half now. So like, I think people are expecting us to go back to the first gig like better than ever, because we've had all this time to practice. But there's nothing like playing to an actual live audience. You can only practice on your own so much.
Totally. I think I had a nightmare a couple of times about getting on stage and like my guitar strap falling off, and just breaking strings, forgetting words. And it is like, it's scary. And I remember even on the last tour, where I felt like I was just about getting used to playing live and feeling confident with those songs. And then it was like the end of the album tour. So it's for me, it takes just a long time for, you know, for it to feel like like absolute second nature, because, you know, it all kind of rests on me to give the best show possible. And I feel very, you know, I owe it to people that come and spend their Thursday night with me to give them the best possible show. So,
that's a great, great way, segue into your first song, if you're ready to.
Sure. Right. So normally, again, it's a shame that there's a bit of a delay on these things, because you could have sang the female part, but...
I know. We could try, but...
Yeah, no, it might be a bit strange. But I just wanted to kind of, I suppose, talk a bit about the songs that kind of kick-started my career, I suppose. And the first song that I'm going to do is kind of, I suppose it feels like the biggest fan favourite song in some ways. Like, it's, you know, people get married to it, you know, it's being used, I even got a message the other day saying that this guy's wife was going into labour, and they wanted it to be their first song when the baby was born, which is quite crazy. But so it's been, and then, you know, some people have, very sadly, you know, been buried to it. So it feels like a big, big song for me, and it kind of kick-started my career. Like, you know, the band Keen, you know, Somewhere Only We Know, all that kind of stuff. Like, they scouted me when they heard this song and gave me my first initial recordings, which then kind of, I suppose, got a bit of interest with the music industry. And it was, it just kind of kick-started everything, really. So
wow,
I thought it'd be a good song to start with. So this one's called Willow Tree, and you can press your button when... here we go. I'm going to take my headphones off as well, guys. Hold me close, love of mine. Promise me that there's always time. Still a place for me by your side. Like a willow tree into its vine, our roots grow close. 'Cause you are the one I need most. I hope you know you are the one I need. And as the seasons roll on by, please remember the reasons why. You and I are two of a kind. Like a willow tree into its vine, our roots grow close. 'Cause you are the one I need the most. I hope you know you are the one I need. You are the one I need the most. I hope you know You were the one I need the most.
That's such a beautiful song.
Oh, thank you so much, Lisa. People, thank you.
People are loving it. I forgot to tell you, I don't know if you worked out, if you can see the comments or not. Can you see on your screen?
Oh, shit, sorry. Yeah. I'm not sure I should
swear. That's okay, no, it's fine. You can swear.
Oh, yes, comments, hey, guys.
I meant to say that, and then you can see, but sometimes people get distracted, so yeah, you can say that.
No worries.
All the lovely comments coming in. I've completely forgot to say as well, and I was just reminded by two very generous tips from RN Robbery. Thank you very much. I forgot to say these shows are completely free to watch, but if anyone can afford to and would like to tip us, me and Tom are sharing all the tips that we make, and we really, really appreciate it. So I forgot to say that at the start. So songwriting. Do you write on your own, or do you co-write? Like that song, for instance, did you write that on your own?
Do you know what? I wrote it with my best mate. And he's a guy. He's in a band in his own right. He's a guy called Mike, and he's in a band called Clean Cut Kid. And we used to live together, and I played him this idea I had for a song, and then he was like, "Let's finish it together," and we ended up finishing it. But yeah, I suppose I do co-write, and then I also write on my own, like the song Everything's Waiting For You. I wrote
personal favourite.
I wrote on my own and co-produced with my friend Rich, and yeah, it really just depends. Like I like writing on my own as much as I like co-writing, really. So I think it's just it's like having mini band members when I co-write, really.
And do you ever write for other? Well, do you co-write for other artists, or is it always for yourself?
Do you know what? I've been doing that a bit more recently. I wrote some songs for a band called Chewing Breaks, who they also write with they write for me as well. And that kind of feels like you're just writing with your friends, really. And that was great, because I've been like a fan of their stuff for a long time. And then I've been writing with kind of a few more people recently, over like things like Zoom for their stuff, and I suppose you just have to see when that comes out, really. But I'm always open to suggestions and ideas, and you know, I just enjoy writing songs. It's you know, that's it, really.
How have you found the Zoom writing?
I
keep asking every guest the same question.
It's a bit like speed dating. Not that I've ever been speed dating, but what I imagine speed dating to be like. It's very quick.
Yeah.
And you don't outstay your welcome.
Which I like.
Yeah. So I if I was doing like a Zoom writing session, it would last about an hour. And I would just get as much as I can in there. Mm-hmm. And then just get out, really. But because I think it's the concentration is quite intense compared to, you know, being in the room with someone. Like, you know, when you're on Zoom, you can't just zone out for like 5 minutes and look at a wall.
Yeah.
So you have
well,
to be
you
like,
can, but...
yeah, it'd be a bit awkward if I'm like, you know, but, so yeah, no, it is good, but you know, you can't beat human contact, you know.
Yeah.
You know, at the moment things are all safe, I'm going to be like, just touching people and like, oh my God, you're in real life. But yeah. But yeah, no, it's all good. I think, you know, we're extremely blessed to have the internet, you know, at this time. So, yeah.
And it's proved, I think, to me that the most amazing thing about Zoom writing, like when that people started doing that at the start, I was like, no, that's not for me. And then I tried one, which is the last song that I'm actually going to play. And I realized it actually allows, we put all these kind of barriers in. Well, I had. Anyway, I mean, there was a guy on this series called Joe. Oh, my God. Joe Dolman.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah. And we were making excuses why we couldn't write together because he lived like 2 hours away. And then this happened. And I was like, we could have literally been writing for like 2 years. So that, I think that part is amazing, and showing us that like actually we can do so much more remotely if we're just kind of forced into doing it.
And you wrote a song together, right?
Yes, we did. I've done a few Zoom writing sessions, yeah, but I'm quite particular because I don't want to try it out with new people just in case it doesn't work and then we have a bad impression of each other writing.
Yeah,
does that make sense?
Yeah.
Cool. I'm going to let you take a little break and I'm going to move on to my second song, if that's all right.
Cool. I'll enjoy listening.
Thank you. Okay. Now, this is a brand new song. Sorry, I just ate a massive burp into the microphone, so classic me. I wrote this with the Dunwells. I can't even remember now, maybe a year or so. No, it must have been longer. But I haven't really done anything with it. And every time I listen to it, I'm like, I really like this song and I think I need a bit of feedback. Sometimes I'm like, I think you can tell if it's a good song, but sometimes I question myself, and yeah, so I thought I'd try it out here. It's actually not finished. I haven't got a middle eight yet, so hoping to go back and sort that out when I go up to record very soon. It's called Believe in Love Again. It's very cheesy, so I apologise in advance for anyone that's about to vomit listening to this song. But the backstory is that I was in quite a lot of, well, not, sorry, that makes me sound really bad. Not a lot, just all the relationships I was in were bad. And I think after a few, you're just like, you just want to give up. And I kind of just got to a point where I was really happy on my own, and I think that's a brilliant place to be, to be happy single, and I think you should be that before you get into another relationship. I think, like RuPaul says, you gotta love yourself before you love anyone else. And then I met my now boyfriend Chrissy, and he taught me to believe in love again, which I know is just disgusting. But yeah, so this is an unfinished song, but I wanted to see what you guys thought. It took a broken heart to see that I could fall in love with ease. But you told me this is what love's meant to be. And all the pain I felt before has made me love you even more. But you showed me this is what love's meant to be. Maybe we're lucky we met, now we're grown. Going against all the love we've been shown. Who'd have known? Who'd have known? Now I believe in love again. Now I believe in love again. All those love affairs of mine, they were painful at the time. But they taught me this is what love's meant to be. Maybe we're lucky we met, now we're grown. Going against all the love we've been shown. Who'd have known? Now Hello? Oh, can't hear you. You muted.
Oh shit! Sorry. I was worried that if I would speak, then it would bleed onto your beautiful song.
Oh no, you're fine. When I take you off, you're muted. I probably should.
Okay,
have told
great,
you that.
great.
All good. So yeah, that's an unfinished song. I need to add a middle eight, I think. But I also think it's one of those songs that it's like when I produce it, I think I'll have maybe more of an idea of where to go with it, but
I didn't think it was cheesy. I don't know why you said it was cheesy.
It's so cheesy. Come on.
I don't think it's cheesy. Anyway.
Maybe you're just kind of a cheesy kind of guy.
Maybe I am. Just guys comment and yeah, someone says not cheesy. Heather says not cheesy.
Oh, so, and Sarah says, you must stop swearing. No, it's okay.
How many times have I sweared? Have I sweared?
It's okay. Twice. It's okay.
Oh, God.
I don't mind.
Yeah.
Right, one second. I had all my notes for questions. Oh, I know okay. What I was going to ask you.
Let's go.
How was Glastonbury?
Oh, it was a long time ago now, wasn't it?
I was there. I watched your set.
Did you? Okay. That's right. It was July... 2019, wasn't it? We did it, yeah.
Was it? I was trying to work out if it was... Because I think it must have been before the house concert that we played at. Because
yeah.
I remember thinking, oh, I need to go and see him. Yes, I know it was, because when I watched you, that's when I realised that you're left-handed and you play a left-handed guitar. And I was like, oh, good to know to not rely on... If something goes wrong with my guitar at the house concert, I can't borrow yours.
Oh no, that feels like a long time ago. But because we were meant to do it again, the following summer, which would have been the COVID year, and so I don't know what, you know. Obviously, it's not happening this summer. So hopefully, yeah, we'll go back next summer maybe. Oh,
what was the stage that you played at again?
We played the acoustic stage, and I to be honest, it was kind of a dream for me because it was just, I always have this fear of like, it's like putting on a birthday party and no one turning up. Like I have that constant fear whenever we do gigs, and it was like really full. So I was just, yeah, really happy.
Yeah, no, I remember watching you and I was like, okay, number one, I'm really jealous. Cause I think that has to be my favorite tent at Glastonbury. I love everyone, but yeah, I was really, really impressed. And even though it said like acoustic, you had like a pretty big sounding, yeah, big sound, I thought.
Oh, thank you.
No, you were so,
yeah,
so
we
good.
We try and kind of, you know, give it a lot of energy, really.
Have you got
so
any...
Much, Susie, thank you.
You're welcome. Are you playing any festivals this year that you can reveal?
Do you know what? I honestly don't know at this. I don't know what's going ahead, what's not going ahead. All I know is that we are definitely, well, fingers crossed that the tour in February is happening. You know, I feel like that's enough time for things to happen, you know. And yeah, that's my main focus, really. And if we do play some festivals this summer, that'd be amazing. But yeah, I think it's got to be safe, really, hasn't it?
Yeah, I think February is very safe. Surely that should go ahead. Where are you playing on your tour in February? And do you have a support act yet?
We are doing London, Manchester, Bristol, Leeds, and I think we're going to add a few more on. And do you know what? It's selling well, which is a relief because I was worried that people wouldn't get tickets because they were worried about COVID and things like that. But yeah, it seems like people are up for the gigs, really, which is nice.
And do you have a support act?
You know what? I don't know, because I don't know, actually. But I, you know, I think we could definitely squeeze you in somewhere.
Sorry, I do.
Where are you based?
London.
Are you based in London? Okay, well, that's easy. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
We came to see your show at Bush Hall.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
That must have been right. I think it was like a few days after the house concert we played it.
Yeah.
I remember me and Chris we had one of your songs in our head. Is it Waiting?
Yes,
It's what I think you do brilliantly in that album is the power of an ooh. I think people underestimate it. Yeah. And you have a couple of songs on that album that I'm like, are the most catchy thing. And you go away from that gig and you, it's in your head for weeks. Yeah.
I'm trying to think if there's any more ooze on this album, this next record.
There better be.
I don't know. So far, there hasn't been an ooh yet, has there? Has there been an ooh on this new stuff? I don't know.
I don't know. Still catchy. Don't worry. You don't need an ooh, but you do an ooh so well.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Do you want to sing your second song for us? And
Sure. Okay. I'm going to play a song called Little Love. And it was the first ever song I released in, I think it was January 2016. And yeah, it was, it's a very special song to me. I'm going to play it for you. This is called Little Love. Oh, I dragged the computer there with me. Here we go. Every little song I write, every memory inside, every little endless night, stumbling around in the neon light. Everybody says to me, oh Tom, there's plenty more fish in the sea, like a pinball machine. But tonight, baby, what I need, every little bit of love was wasted on us. Every gift from above was not meant for us. Nobody ever tried. Nobody wants to fall behind. Nobody wants to cry over a little love. Every little moment left, picking up the pieces you possess. Every little sleepless night, I was wrong and you were right. Staring at the movie screen, life replays every single scene. And do I really want to know as I watch you go? Yeah. As I watch you go. Every little bit of love was wasted on us. Every gift from above was not meant for us. Nobody ever tried. Nobody wants to fall behind. Nobody wants to cry over a little love. And I'll catch you when you come back round, searching through the lost and found. And I'll find you in every little bit of love was wasted on us. Every gift from above was not meant for us. Nobody ever tried. Nobody wants to fall behind. Nobody wants to cry over a little. Thank you so much. I like that you've got a bit of a delay in on your clap, so it sounds like there's more claps.
Yeah, there's more. Oh, I can't wait to hear claps again.
I think my sister's watching. She's very active.
Sarah?
She's very active on the comments section, which is nice. Hey, Sarah.
That was the person who was telling you not to swear, which makes so much more sense now.
Thanks
for tuning in, sister. So you wrote that in, did you say 2016?
Yes, I probably wrote it in 2015, but I recorded it that summer and then it was out, I think, January the 2016, in 2016.
So you still enjoy playing the songs? I'm always scared that I'll, like, get really sick of playing songs that I wrote years and years ago, but it doesn't seem that you do, so that's...
No, I'm incredibly thankful for that song. Like, it was, that song was everything to me when it first came out. It kind of, it gave me a career, I suppose, in some ways. Yeah. And it's just, I'm just thankful for it, really.
What would you say is, like, the biggest thing? Was it the Keane thing, or, like, what has kind of... Do I want to say the word propelled? Is that what I want to say? Propelled your career?
Yeah,
that...
I get. I think. Do you know what? I don't think it's just one thing. I think
no, it can't be one.
No, I think for me, my main like objective is just to kind of keep going, mm-hmm. and you know, I'd love it if I was like 10 albums deep, and you know, just you know, I want to have like a long career of just playing music, really, and. You know, I don't expect to be like, you know, playing stadiums or being the next Ed Sheeran or anything like that. I just think as long as I can play music, I'm kind of happy with that, you know. And I don't see it as just doing one thing. I think it's like, it's almost like drip feeding kind of everything, yeah. You know, whether it being gigs or someone catching your music on a TV show or hearing you on the radio. I think it's just it's a lot of things like just trying, you know, just building up really, I think.
Speaking of radio, we have to talk about Radio 2. And other radio, but I am so jealous because I got song which I'm going to play. And it got onto like the new to-two list, so not playlisted. But for me, that was absolutely like huge. And I started listening, I think it's everyone... Everything's Waiting for You.
Yeah.
I realized I was hearing it every single day, and then I saw that it got playlisted on. Yeah. It got to B, right?
Yeah.
Huge.
No, do you know what? I feel it. It kind of took me by surprise, to be honest. It's just so hard, man.
Yeah.
It's so hard to get on these playlists, and you should feel really proud as well that, you know, the new to two. It's just, you know, I think how many singer-songwriters there are doing music, and yeah, I just think I felt really, really lucky, to be honest. And, you know, I feel like I wasn't deserving of that spot, but I was just incredibly grateful.
Oh, really. So deserving, because as well, that song in particular, it started off on the C list, right?
Yeah.
And then it got to the B list, so it definitely... I don't know who makes those decisions, but that's a definite you deserve to be there. And also, I read somewhere, tell me if this is wrong, your 7 singles in a row got playlisted on Radio 2. Is that right?
Yeah, that is correct. Yeah, we had one other B-list, which was Waiting.
Oh, yes. Great song.
Yeah, which is the catchy ooh song that you like. Do you know what? I don't know. I think I don't know. I'd you know, it'd be great if every one of them could keep on getting playlisted, but we've just got to see how it goes.
I guess
it's so hard. It is so hard.
It's that expectation now. It's like once you get one song playlisted, you're like the next one. If it doesn't, you're like what have I done wrong? Yeah, and it's horrible, that expectation. And I think being a musician as well, it's like we're always on to the next thing. So even when you release an album, when you release your album, people will be like, when's the next album coming out? And you're like, can I just sit for a minute?
Yeah.
And I just enjoy this.
It's hard to enjoy things as well, because you don't... I personally never really celebrate anything. Like, I don't drink anyway. So I don't know if I was going to celebrate. It'd be like, hey guys, come around mine for a cup of tea. Shit's going to go off. Sorry, I swore again.
It's fine.
But yeah, so it's like, I don't really know how I would celebrate. But yeah, so I just, if we, you know, when we got the B list, I was just kind of worried about the next single. It was like, it's hard to, I think most musicians struggle to live in the present. And they always do like worry about the future, really. Because I think that's just the nature of the beast.
That's so sad, isn't it, when we say that? But
yeah.
But it's true. I'm going to sing my next song. And I loved this moment, right? You wouldn't have even known that this happened. But your song, I was told that it's Broken Home. And that's the one that Joe Wiley and Jeremy Vine played. And the reason why I got that Radio 2 connection is because, I don't know if you know this, but you probably do because I talk about it all the time. Jeremy Vines spotted me busking, and that led on to like a Radio 2 session, and he's played a bunch of my singles on his show. Have you not heard me say that before?
That's, do you know, crazy. I did hear it. I wanted you to tell the story. You told that at the gig.
Yeah, of course I did.
But it's no, and you know, it is a great story because, you know, the likelihood and chances of that happening is pretty crazy.
I love Jeremy Vine so much. But yeah, this single made it to the new to-do list, which meant not just Jeremy Vine could play it. So Joe Wiley played it, and then I got kind of, they told me that the show on a Sunday morning, I can't think of the name of the person now.
Michael Ball?
Awful. No. It was like 6 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, I know the one. Yeah. It's a duo, isn't it?
But and the woman is on, she used to be on Gogglebox, and she's a priest. But she wasn't on it.
It's Katie.
Jason.
Yeah,
Mohammed.
Katie and Jason. Yeah.
Something like that.
We should edit this bit out so they
don't. I know. Oh, damn it. I don't think they'll be watching. It's fine. Anyway, I got told that Broken Home was potentially going to be played on that show.
Yeah.
So, obviously, you wouldn't have done this. But the chances of my song being played, I was like, I'm getting up. So I got up at 6 o'clock in the morning and just listened to the radio. And your song came on, which made me happy anyway. And then my song came on straight afterwards.
No way.
Yeah. And I was like, it's fate. But the most annoying thing was, you know how normally you get a tweet afterwards from Radio 2 saying you'd been played?
Yeah.
Someone hadn't put something in the system. So my song wasn't on, like, the record. So no one else will have known that unless they were listening live.
Lucy, I can top that story if you want.
Go on.
Okay, so my first ever radio play on Radio 2 was for Little Love. Yeah. And it came, you know, you wait for this thing, just played on Radio 2, and it said Tim Speight. So, like, you know, my glory moment was Tim Speight. And I called my manager and I was like, we need to fire someone. Whose fault is this? And forever he just shouts Tim at me.
That's so annoying. The thing is, like,
but it's you've got to laugh at it, haven't you, really?
Well, I was very angry. But but afterwards you're like, oh, I guess it's not the end of the world. It's just because really no one's going to go back on the Radio 2 tweets and go,
yeah.
Oh, this person.
Do you know what?
Yeah.
It would have been logged on the Radio 2 player, but just not on the Twitter.
No, not on the website. It wasn't there.
I don't know.
Yes, so annoying. Anyway, doesn't matter. Joe Wiley played me and everything's fine.
She's like the coolest as well.
After Jeremy. Jeremy's the coolest.
Jeremy is the very cool as well. Yeah.
Right, I'm gonna play this song, otherwise we're going to go over the time limit. So,
yeah.
Here we go. This is the song of that story, and it's called Broken Home.
Just look at what we built together. The plans we made are meant forever. So where do we go from here? Where do we go? Time for starting over. Let's start with all the things we love about each other. Where do we go from here? Where do we go? Ooh.
We don't need another broken home. We don't need to do this on our own. I just wanna be with you. So I try after everything I steal, but leave, you give me everything I need, and I wanna give that too. So I try eyes and days unwind. We might stumble from time to time, but all we can do is try. We don't need another broken home. We don't need to do this on our own. I just wanna be with you. So I try after everything I feel, but babe, you give me everything I need, and I wanna give that too. So I try, don't need another broken home. We don't need to do this on our own. I just wanna be with you. So I try, after everything I still believe, you give me everything I need, and I wanna give that too. So I try. As heard on Radio 2. At 6 o'clock in the morning. Just before I bring Tom back on, I just want to say a couple of thank yous to some tips I just saw come through. Thank you so much to Dan Bennett, who said, great show with Tom, Orna, and Jennifer. Thank you for doing these Songwriter Series sessions. You are welcome. And if anyone would like to tip tonight, don't feel obliged to, but if you can and would like to, anything we make, we split between us, and obviously... we haven't really had an income for the past year or so. So anything would be really, really appreciated.
I was clapping. I was clapping right at the end of the song.
I saw you. And I saw you drumming.
Yeah, I was. Because I feel like it needs one of those shaker vibes. But yeah.
I know. I'm so excited to play that live with a band. There's only so much you can do. How am I can't take this thing off. Hold on. Title. Sorry. There we go. Okay.
Deep breath.
I don't want this to end. It goes so quickly, honestly. I'm looking at the time. I'm like, I want to ask him so many more questions, but we'll have to do something like this again. And
we'll do it again, yeah, when the album comes out or something.
Yes. Can you reveal when the album is coming out? Probably not.
Yeah, no, it's do you know what, guys? It's up for pre-order, so go and pre-order it now. It's called Everything's Waiting For You, and it comes out on September the 24th.
Everything's waiting for you.
So there you go.
Love it.
Yeah.
Oh, you just tell me, yeah. When does it come out?
September the 24th.
Is that public knowledge?
Yeah, it's up for pre-order. We went to number one in the iTunes pre-order charts the other day. There you go.
I saw that.
Yeah,
also,
that's the album. Yeah.
Can you tell us about the cleverly placed little plaque thing behind you?
Oh,
this little thing.
Oh, do you know what? It's because it's I thought it was actually behind me there, but my debut album Collide went to number one in the indie charts, which is the only thing I've celebrated. So there you go. So you have to pay for that?
No,
they don't just give you it for free.
No.
Yeah, 100%. So you go to number one, and they're like, if you want an award, your label has to basically pay for it. So there's a little bit of an in. Yeah, yeah.
I didn't know. Of course you're on a label. I didn't even think about. I always just assume that no one is.
Do you know what? I actually did pay for it because we on the first on the first record. So this is like my David Brent coming into play here, guys. The first record, we did have a label, but we actually parted ways with them to sign to a big label on the second record. So there was no way they were going to buy me that after we left them on the first record. So, I was going to swear then, but I thought, do you know what? I'm just going to celebrate something. There we go.
How did you celebrate? Because you don't drink.
Do you know what? I just looked at it for about 3 seconds. And went, that's great. And then that was it. But, I think it's pretty cool. And, it might never happen again. So why not?
Well, I have very big expectations. I know that you don't want to hear that for your next album, but I have very big expectations. And if it's the singles that have come out already is anything to go by, it's going to be amazing.
It'd be amazing if we had another one, because then I could have like them as like, I don't know, books, I don't know, paperweights or something. I don't know what people use them for these days.
What are they called? And bookends.
Bookends, that's it, yeah. Yeah, that's making me sound very cool.
I have a couple of questions before you head on to your last song.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for artists maybe starting out or like near the beginning of their career?
Okay.
Just me, basically.
Are we talking like in COVID situation or not?
Forget that exists.
Okay, because that is just like, where do you start with that? I don't even know how to navigate a way out of that. I think, to be honest, I think I'm an average singer-songwriter at best, and I'm being serious when I say that. But
no.
I think I surround myself with good people.
Mm-hmm.
So like my Lydia, who sings with me, is just a fantastic singer. Like, you know, like she's, if God was making angels, Lydia would be an angel singing her heart out, you know?
That's lovely.
I think, you know, just my band are great. And I think my manager's great. And I think just I surround yourself with good people you trust and like. And I think if it doesn't work out, at least you had some fun, you know? I think if you work with people you don't really like and you're not making music you don't really like, what's the point?
Yeah, that's very good advice. How do you find these people? Because you sang with Lydia, that she's the one you normally sing with, but I also saw you play with Eliza Shaddad, who has also been a guest on this. How do you meet people? Is it just through gigging or?
Do you know what? I'm trying to think how I met Eliza. It feels like, I feel like I've known her for ages. We've probably known each other like 6 years, but it feels like a lot longer. But I go to a lot of gigs and I saw Lydia singing in a choir and I just went up to her and said, look, I'm looking for a choir at one of my next concerts. Could your choir come and sing at my choir? And then we kind of just got on from there really. And she's just been like a very natural singer and a great person to be around. And it was kind of, it just felt right that she should join the team really.
I wish she was here to be playing with you at the moment, but I love listening to you on your own. I think she's probably a comfort blanket for you, isn't she, to have?
Oh, completely. Yeah, she's like, she makes me sound good. So
you sound great.
It feels like I've got a cape on when I'm with her because I'm like some superhero or something. But
I hope she listens back to this and realizes how much she means to you, because those are some of the nicest words I've ever heard.
We wrote a song together, actually, that comes out on the next record, and it's brilliant. And she met, you know, there's like, it feels like a bit like a giant family, because she met her boyfriend, who plays drums with me, through the project, and it just does feel a bit like a family. And not like a Fleetwood Mac family, you know, like a dysfunctional one, like a good one, you know. So, it's going to be fun when we're going to be allowed to do some gigs again.
Oh, amazing. Last question from me before you do your last song. And I know that this isn't the song that you're going to play, but can you just tell us about your most recent single, Soak Up?
Yeah, sure. It's called Soak Up and God, it's really difficult. This is, I haven't got into promo mode with the song yet, but it's a song. I was single at the time and I was a bit lost. And I think I was kind of just, I felt like the world had given me a massive punch in the face and I was just kind of waiting to bounce back. I don't know if you can relate to that. And I felt really flat at the time. And it's a kind of a song about longing to just be with someone. And when you do have that opportunity, just giving your all to that person. And I'm actually in a relationship now, which is great. And in a pandemic as well. I feel very lucky that I feel like I timed it brilliantly. It just happened just before the pandemic started. So, it's a song about kind of longing to be with someone, knowing that you'll do everything you can to make it work when it happens. So, it's quite a summery song. And it was the first song we recorded when lockdown one was lifted and I recorded it, I was wearing some shorts and the London was sunny. It was like a heat wave. It couldn't have been a better time to record music, really.
Oh, amazing. Right. Before we run over time, please do introduce us to your last song.
Yeah. Just before I go as well, I just want to say thank you so much, Lucy, and thank you for people tuning in. And yeah, I'd love to come back and do this again, and we'll do some more shows as well.
Yes, absolutely. Oh, thank you. Thanks for coming on.
No worries. So this is a song called Journey, guys. Thank you so much for listening, and yeah, I hope you've had a nice night. Joni wears a heart on her sleeve, 'cause she thinks it's the only place that it should be. And I don't mind as long as there's space, oh space, in a heart for me. Joni lives her life like a fast train, somehow she still winds up at home. And I don't mind as long as there's a place, a place in a life. No worry in my heart might send us back to the start, but you and me, Joni, will make it far. Joni likes to spend most of her time listening to worn-out records, drinking fine wine. And I don't mind as long as there's a time, or a time in a day for me. And Joni, please allow me just one more chance to rewrite my wrongs and take you by the hand. Oh, I'm sorry, I doubted you. Oh, I hope you understand. And the worry in my heart might send us back to the start, but you and me, Joni, will make it far. Go! Back to the start, but you and me, Joni, will make it far. 'Cause in 10 years' time, I see you're still lying there next to me. Say, you and me, Joni, this is only the start. And me, Joni, will make it far. Say, you and me, Joni, this is only the start.
Woo!
Thank you so much, guys. Thank you.
Tom, thank you so, so much. Thank you. You've been amazing. I'm gonna make sure I share all of your social media and stuff, but just to so people can find you, just Tom Speight
music
on everything, pretty
yeah,
much.
Cool. Tom Speight music, yeah.
Thank you so much for coming on, and good luck with the album, and hope to see you very, very soon.
Thanks so much. Thank you, Lucy. Thank you. Have a great night, guys. Thanks. Do I just sign out? What do
I'm
I do?
I'm going to remove you, but everyone watching, please stay with me because I've got something that I'm going to play. So, yeah, you can just sign out. Bye.
Bye, bye, bye.
Okie dokie. So, I've got something to share with you as a special goodbye to everyone. So I just want to say thank you so, so much to everyone. Have I done that? There we go. Thank you so, so much to everyone that's tuned in. I've been doing this for 7 weeks now, and I have really, really enjoyed doing them. And it's been amazing to have so many guests on. I just want to say thank you also, especially to anyone that has tipped. There's been people tipping every single week, and I know that everyone's kind of having a very difficult time financially, but thank you so much to anyone that has helped with that. And thank you to all the people that have tipped tonight. And yeah, if you can afford to do so, we obviously still not gigging at the moment, so anything you can afford to tip, please do. But otherwise, thank you guys so much. And I'm going to leave you with this. And I can't wait to see you guys in real life at a gig sometime soon. Stay safe. Thank you so much. A love to all of you.